यस्य आत्मा एव नान्यः कामे तदेह
वस्तुन्दरहूतः प्राप्तोति। श्रीदानगिरि तस्य युक्तम आत्मक आप्त कामत्वम विशेषः। तस्य आप्त कामस्य विदुषः this vidwan, this wise person of whom all the desires are fulfilled, tasya yuktam apta kamatvam. It is quite right that, quite appropriate that he is apta kama, he is the one whose desires are all fulfilled. Footnote number 8 should better be atma kamasya vidushah, really. So, atma kamasya vidushah yuktam apta kamatvam. Katham apta kama? How come he is the one whose desires are fulfilled? Because he is atma kama. Because for whom all the kamas have reduced to atma. Uktamartham pramana pradashanartham prapanchayati. Uktamartham, that for him everything has become atma. Pramana pradashanartham prapanchayati. So in order to show the pramanam, uktamartham prapanchayati, Bhashyakara explains it. So details it.
आत्मैव अनन्तरः अबाह्यः रसनः प्रज्ञानघनः एकरसः न ऊर्ध्वः न तिर्यक् न अधः आत्मनः अन्यत् कामैतव्यम् वस्तुअंतरं। आत्मा एव अनंतरः अवाह्यः कृष्णः प्रज्ञानघनः एकरसः। आत्मा एव अनंतरः, devoid of any innerness, अवाह्यः, devoid of the idea of outsideness. So insideness and outsideness, आत्मा is devoid of these ideas. Krishna, he is complete. Prajnana ghana, he is just homogeneous. Ekarasaha, homogeneous. When there is insideness, that means there is something that I am not, inside. Outsideness means what? Somewhere where I am not. So there, if Atma is some place where Atma is not, there cannot be ekarasyam or homogeneity. So prajnana ghana, that ekarasa, the homogeneous truth is what? Prajnana ghana. A mass of consciousness. So Atma is Krishna, complete, purely consciousness, homogeneous. So, na urdhvam, na tiryaka, na adhaha. Atmanah anyat kamaitavyam vastvantaram. For there is no kamaitavyam, there is nothing that is desirable. Vastvantaram, something that is different from the Atma, urdhvaha, above, tiryak, on the side, adaha, below, above, below, on the side, there is nothing now that is other than Atma, therefore there is kamaitavyam, that can become the object of desire. Because there is no vastvantara bhutam, there is nothing separate from him. So pramana pradashanatham, Bhashyakara wants to show pramana for this. For showing that, first of all, prapanchayati gives a meaning of what that pramana vakya has to say. And then, kamaitavya bhavam brahma vidaha sutyavastambhena svashtayati. That for the brahma vid, kamaitavya bhavaha, there is no kamaitavya, nothing that is desirable. Sutyavastambhena, which supports the sudhi, svashtayati, Bhashyakara clarifies, yastayati on the page 15.
यस्य सर्वं आत्मैवाभूत् तत्केनकं पश्येत् शृणुयात् मन्वीत विजानीयात् वा एवं विजानन् कं कामयेत्।
यस्य सर्वं आत्मैवाभूत् यस्य विज्ञातुः
Saram Atmaiva Bhut. For this knower, everything has become the self, and when everything is known as a self,
that tasma, therefore, kena kampashet,
what can he see with what?
So the very sphere is not there, what is to be seen is not there, the means of seeing also is not there, as much as the sphere, the seen, the means of seeing and the seeing, the seer, seen, seeing and the means of seeing, all of these are reduced to the self in his knowledge now. That is one consciousness who is a knower, is the very same consciousness. So very one consciousness with the upadhi of the ahankara becomes a knower.
Or buddhi upadhi becomes a knower. The same consciousness with the upadhi of naam rupa becomes a known. And the same consciousness with the vritti upadhi becomes a knowing.
And same consciousness with the upadhi of the instrument of knowledge becomes the means of knowledge. So what we call pramata, prameya, prama and pramanam, that's the vyavahara. So jnata, jnaya, jnanam. And then he, what is the means of jnanam? So like that, this is how karma, karta, karanam, so forth and so on. Everywhere this vyavahara is there. Each one of these is known to be nothing at one self of the consciousness. Consciousness assuming different forms or different costumes and appears in all these different ways. This is what one sees. So yasya saram atmaiva bhut, when everything has become reduced. Everything is reduced to the self. Tat kena kampashed. Then kena, with what means of knowledge? Kam, with what object of knowledge? So kena here is the pramana. So kena pramanena kam prameyam pashed. What is that object that stands apart from him, that he can see with the means of knowledge, again that is different from him? Shruyat manvita vijaniyatva. Or what it is that he can hear, or know, or think. Evam vijanam, kam kamayet. So when everything is known as a self, kam kamayet, what is that he can desire? Because nothing that can become the object of desire, no such thing remains anymore in his vision. Anandikrishna, vidyavastha yasya vidushasti saha anyam avijanan na kanchidabhi kamayeta iti yojana. It is in this manner, yasya vidushaha vidyavasthasti. So yasya, for this vidwan, for him the vidyavastha, in so when he comes to gain this knowledge, saha anyam avijanan, so when he knows nothing other than himself, so there is no non-self remaining in his perception. Na kanchita vikamayeta. He cannot desire anything at all. Iti yojana. This is how we understand the vakya. Then Srila Anandagiri. Padartha anyatvena avijnadopi kamaitavya syadhi chen. Padartha anyatvena avijnadopi. It's all right. Even if you know something is non-separate from yourself, anyatvena avijñātopi, the point that is made here is that when something is known as different from yourself, then alone it can become the object of desire. Why is it so? After an object is there, even if you know it as yourself, why can it not become the object of desire? The question is, why is it that something cannot become the object of desire just because it is not separate from yourself? Padartha anyatvena avijnadavi kamaitavyasyat, it can still become the object of desire, iti chet na ityaha jnayamanohi. Says Bhashyakara, jnayamanohi anyatvena padartha kamaitavyo bhavati. Anyatvena jnayamanaha padarthahi kamaitavya bhavati. Only when padartha or object is known anyatvena as separate from oneself, then alone kamaimanu bhavati, it can become the object of desire. Sri Anagiri, anubhute smarana viparivarti virtini kamaniyamadityarthaha anubhute. So desire can be with reference to what? desire can be with reference to anubhute, something that has been experienced. So in the mind, when the desire arises, there is generally a specific object of desire. So what it is that can become the object of desire? Anubhute, something that is experienced. Smarana viparivartani, not only something that is experienced, but something that now has come to my mind. So something that I remember. So something that I experienced in the past, and that becomes now an object of my memory. As footnote number 4 says, smarana vishayi bhavati vastuni. Smarana vishayi bhavati, that is also seventh case, vastuni. So that vastu that becomes the vishaya, the object of smarana. So something that I have experienced, and that which has now become the object of memory, that alone can become the object of desire. That's all. Kama niyamat, there is a rule that alone can become the object of desire. Something that has come to my memory. And what can come to my memory? Only something that has been experienced in the past. So, yai smritihi sa anubhav purvika. This memory always presupposes an experience. So Bhashyakara says, therefore, anyatvena jnayamano padartha, jnayamana padartha kamaitavya bhavati. Only, so jnayamana, when something is known to me, jnayamana is anubhuta, something that is known to me, experienced by me. And experienced by me as something different from myself, then alone it can become the object of memory today, and then alone it can possibly become the object of desire. There is no rule that whatever it is that I remember becomes the object of desire, but then whatever becomes the object of desire must necessarily be something that is I remember in my mind. Yeah, the other day I experienced this, how about having it again? So the other day we did this, how about doing it again? So the desire always is reference to something that I remember, and I remember fondly, I guess, If I remember something with, then also that desire can arise. So then there can be desire to get rid of something or reject something, or So either desire to acquire or desire to get rid of. These desires require a memory, and memory presupposes a pleasant or unpleasant experience. So it was anyatvena jnayamana. An object that is known as something different from myself alone can become the object of desire. Then says Anagari, anyatvena jnayamana stari padartha virusobhi kamayatavya. Fine. If this is what you say, that a padartha, an object, can become the object of desire when it is experienced as something from myself, fine. Let the wise man also, let things become the object of desire for the wise person also, because he also experiences them. Anyatvena jnayamana. So jnana seva kama vishatva niyame. So my desire is always within the scope of my knowledge. So ichha is always within the scope of my jnanam or the knowledge. An unknown object can never become an object of desire. Something that I have never known cannot become the object of desire. Whatever I have, something that I have known, in some ways can become the object of desire. So, jnayamanasyeva kam vishetva niyame. Only that which is known can become the object of desire. That being the case, so says Anagiri, anyatvena jnayamanastari padartha vidusobhi kamaitavya syat. Even for the wise man also, there are many things in the world that are different from him, and they can become the object of desire. Iti asaṅkyaḥ na caiti. Says Vāśya, na ca asau anyaḥ brahma vidaḥ apta kāmasya asti. Na ca asau padārthaḥ. There is no padārthaḥ, so brahma vidaḥ apta kāmasya asti. For brahma vid, for the knower of Brahman, apta kama, one whose desires are all fulfilled, there is no object that stands apart from him. Yasadu, yasya sarvani bhutani, atma eva bhut vijanataha. So when all the things became atma. This is Sri Dhanagiri, Aptakamasya Brahma Vidaha Darshadaritya Kamaita Vyabhave Mukti Siddha. Aptakamasya Brahma Vidaha. For the knower of Brahma, whose desires are fulfilled, Darshadaritya, by the manner in which it has been shown, Kamaitavya Bhave, what is the manner that is shown? That everything has become Atma for him. That being the case, Kamaitavya Bhava, there is nothing that is Kamaitavya or something that is desired or desired, that can become the object of desire, Mukti Siddha. When there is no desire, there is liberation. This is how simple. Liberation is freedom from desire. Bondage is being compelled by the desire. So if that is a desire which does not compel me, then it's okay. It's not desire that is really bondage. It's being compelled that is bondage, that's all. Something that compels me. That means I do not have the freedom. When a desire arises in me, I say, forget it. I don't care. Or I say, no, let it be there. If a desire arises, I say, okay, fine, thank you. Or be there, be my guest, you know, suppose I can say. Any thought arises, anything happens, I can say, be my guest. This is an expression, you know. So, may I come in? What shall I do? Be my guest. Please do that, you know. Suppose I can say that to anything that happens around me and that happens within me. If I am comfortable with what is around me and comfortable with what is within me, then there is nothing in the world that can compel me at all. Nothing in the world. Nobody can compel anything. And I am not comfortable, that is it. All that something has to do is to create in me a sense of discomfort, that's all. And uncomfortable I cannot be. And I have to do something. That is how the desire arises. That desire, but even if a desire arises, if that desire does not compel me to do something, okay? That's the kind of point that Swami Dayanandji always wants to make. Somehow, he doesn't like the idea that desire is, somehow desire appears to be condemned in this, which is not the idea here anyway. But desire is the very first manifestation of ignorance. And we must know that as long as there is desire in my mind, there is some lack. Desire always reveals a certain lack on my part. It is lack which is the bondage. But then there can be a condition where there can be a desire in my mind without the lack. Suppose there is a desire which is unopposed to completeness. That I am a full or complete being, and there can be a desire in the complete being also, then it's okay. If such a desire can be there. Even raga dvesha, anything in the world can be there, as long as it is not opposed to completeness. Suppose there are likes and dislikes, you know, raga dvesha also, which in some way does not assault my completeness. Then whether to call them raga dvesha is, of course, is one's own thing, but the idea is that as long as I am not compelled, that's all. As long as I am free to do something or free not to do something. This is what Bhashyakara would call sarva karma sannyasi. Sarva sankalpa sannyasi yoga rudas tadocchade. Then sarva sankalpa sannyasi or sarva karma sannyasi. All the karma arises from kama and kama arises from sankalpa. When sankalpas are not there, kamas cannot be there, kamas are not there, karma also is not there and so forth. So that's one way of describing what is meant by bondage. In as much as this culture is all karma oriented, duty oriented, kartavya, not karma, but kartavya oriented. Therefore, the bondage is described in terms of kartavya. It can be described in many ways. Shoka is another thing to describe the bondage. Bhaya is yet another thing to describe the bondage. And kartavya is yet another thing to describe the bondage. And why kartavya? Because, as we say, kartavya is presented to us as a means of our own spiritual progress. So kartavya, the duty, is something that is prescribed by the scriptures as a means of one's own spiritual progress. And inasmuch as kartavya, the duty, is an elevating factor, Bhashyakara always wants to make a point that a time comes when you do not require it. That a time comes when you become free from the need of that kartavya also. That it has done what it needs to do, and that it cannot give you moksha all the way. It can bring you so far, but not all the way. Ultimately, it is jnanam, which only takes you to moksha, and so the kartavya karma has done its role. The mimamsakas have a problem with that. Mimamsakas always have a problem because they look upon karma as a means of moksha. So that is why whenever Bhashyakara emphasizes sarva karma sannyasa, etc., it is mainly keeping in mind those people who look upon karma or kartavya rather as something that is a lifetime necessity. And they firmly believe that unless you perform your obligatory duties, that as long as you are alive, you are obliged. Yavat jivam agnihotram juhuyat. Since you are alive, that means that there are forces of nature that keep you alive. That means that you are drawing the support of the nature and support of the world. So you are benefiting from the scheme of the things, and therefore it becomes your duty to return that favor. That's all. So kartavya, the duty, is nothing but performing an action in the spirit of returning the favor. And that favored you are. Even if you become wise, you do not become free from the favor of the world, because still breathe the air, you still drink water, you still enjoy the sunshine, you still eat food, and thus nature continues to serve you. That means that you continue to be obliged. Even every moment that I breathe the air, there is an obligation, because that is given free to me. And therefore it becomes my duty to do something to return that favor. This is the principle of the Mimamsakas. Yavat jivam agnihotram juhuyat. As long as one is alive, so long one must perform agnihotra, means one must perform the duties to the gods and to the various elements which in fact support my life. Bhashyakara says this is not case. There is an exception, and the wise person is an exception to this, inasmuch as he doesn't draw anything from anywhere. He does not draw any favor from anybody. Inasmuch as he does not want food. If you want this body to continue, let it continue. That's what he says. He says that I do not even insist that this body has to continue the existence. He does not insist upon anything. When he has become totally non-demanding person. Bhashyakara says that not that you are alive, therefore you are obliged, but if you are demanding, then alone there is obligation. So when I make a demand, then there is an obligation. If I don't make a demand, that means, and still the body goes on, that means that it is a samashti of the totality that keeps this body going. And that I do not demand that this body also has to go on. Suppose one can become that non-demanding. And Bhashyakara also repeats in many places that even in Sharira Yatra also, one who is free from a desire, even as far as keeping the body alive is concerned, one has become free even from that desire. Then what? Well, you can't do anything to this person. So then what can you do? Then all night, Marwat, Mahidai, Chamra, what do whatever you want to do, you know? Sometimes they say this. Suppose you just don't care for anything. Then what? There are people who say, like Mahatma, it just did not matter. If you take my life away, you take it. That's all. Now, when that does not matter, when your life also does not matter, then what can anybody do? The most that one can do is what? To kill you. All right, here I am. I don't want any security. Look at him, you know. Whether that is right or wrong is a different matter. But then this is, you know, this was his inner... So whether his inner conviction should have become this kind of vyavahara is a matter of question, you know. That's all right. Whether he should have not allowed himself to be protected by the security, that was his personal decision. We may not agree with that. So people say that he made mistakes. That is okay. He can commit mistakes as far as vyavahara is concerned. As far as conviction is concerned, there is no question about it. And that's where our connection is. Our connection is with his convictions, with his perception, and not necessarily what he does. We may choose not to do things that way, with the same conviction, you know, that's all right. Or you may choose, I do not know. But how the conviction is manifested in a given vyavahara, that may be, that's individual upadhi. That's the reason why the conviction that I am a complete being manifests as a lot of work in some case and remaining in the cave in the third case and whatever it is. Therefore, one conviction alone can manifest in different ways, depending on the prarabdha, depending on the upadhi. But the idea is freedom is not being compelled. And when we say he has become free from desire, understand, he has become free from demands. He is a non-desiring person, means a non-demanding person. That's all. A desire must be equated to demand, and definitely one has to become free from that. I make the slightest demand, definitely I am. So whatever it is that fulfills my demand is a controlling factor. So when I seek something, when I want something or desire something, then I always, the one who fulfills my demand is an upper hand. I am controlled by that which fulfills the demand, regardless of what the demand is. And therefore, one thing is certain, akamayamanaha muchyate, only one who has become totally non-demanding person, muchyate, he is free. That is, the bondage manifests itself in the form of demand. Let us say, whenever the scriptures use the word kama, we should understand the word kama as demand, making a demand upon something. So thus, making a demand is the manifestation of bondage. Because I make demand, that means I place myself in a condition where I will be manipulated or controlled by something. When I place something at a pedestal where it can oblige me, then naturally I become controlled. That means I am bound. Since Bhashyakara says that such a thing is there, that there can be a state because of knowledge, when a person can become totally non-demanding. This is most amazing thing. How can you become non-demanding? You still have the same body. You still have the same stuff. You still have the same sense of incompleteness at the level of the upadhi. Even with all the limitations of upadhi, one can still become totally non-demanding. For the very simple reason is that the self is aptakamaha. The self is that which is free from all the demands. That is Krishna. Said avahya krishna, it is complete in itself. It doesn't require anything other than itself to be complete. That being the case, one who abides in that self can become a non-demanding person. And that is freedom. You need nothing else to become free. No other siddhis are required. If they come, fine, enjoy them. But then one does not require any siddhi other than this siddhi, that one has become a non-demanding person. And you cannot become non-demanding by will. I cannot non-demand by will, because that is another demand. I don't care. That is also a demand. And so, non-demandingness has to happen. It cannot be something that can be a product of will. It has something that has to happen. When can it happen? Only in the wake of discovery of myself as a complete being. And that self can never be upadhi, because upadhi can never be complete. So only when the asmat pratyaya, that the sense of I-ness, is now focused upon the true I, which is, as Bhashyakara says, prajnanagana, pure consciousness, Krishna, that consciousness is self-revealing, self-shining, self-existing, self-complete. So it is self-sufficient, put it this way. Self-existing, self-shining, self-sufficient. Only when I discover the self to be that, then alone I am totally assured, I am totally relaxed. And therefore, I see no need to make a demand to be what I am. To exist, I don't need to make any demand. To shine, I don't need to make any demand. To accept myself, I don't need anything. To accept the world, I don't need anything. To accept everything, that means to love. Accept means love. To love myself, I don't need anything. To love the world, I don't need any change. The world does not... If I can love something, only when that thing changes, then I am obliged. I say, no, be like this, then only I can love you. It says, well, it's up to me whether to become like that or not. Suppose it doesn't. It remains where it is. Then I cannot love that. That's it. Then there is an incompleteness. So, even though as I said Vedanta, nowhere in Vedanta seems they seem to use the word love, very rarely if it is, we have not yet come across it anyway, in case they use it, but this is how we should understand. They don't see the need to use it, I guess, because it's something that is natural. But ultimately, this knowledge must make me a loving person, an accepting person, a non-demanding person doesn't mean an indifferent person. A non-demanding person doesn't mean I don't care. That is not a non-demanding person. A non-demanding person is necessarily a giving person. And a loving person is always a giving person. All of these become the, you know, this become the criteria as to what is, and this is all we can do. See, Vedanta presents before us the values which are possible for us to follow. If they give us a value that you must raise your kundalini from, then I don't know whether I can follow or not. I don't say that is wrong. Or something must happen within your head, something must happen someplace. If some kind of a system demands a happening, then I cannot control it. But Vedanta does not demand any happening. All it demands is an understanding, in the wake of understanding, and that buddhi can do. Buddhi has that much capability of understanding. That's all that Vedanta demands. In the wake of understanding, all this happens. That means all the forces are, all the goodness that is within me gets released. Right now, the very goodness in me, forget the word divinity also, even just the goodness. There's the goodness that is already there is at the moment stifled, is blocked. Because all these Brahma, all these illusions and delusions and stupidities and on my part, that's all. So my very goodness gets bottled up. All we need to do is to release it. You don't have to acquire it. I don't have to become good. I don't have to bring it, import it from someplace. I don't have to import anything from anywhere. Any good thing I don't have to import. Any stupid thing I must import, that's all. But no good things I need to import because that is what I am. And all I need to do is to remove the barrier which blocks it, which stifles it. That's all we have to do. And that barrier is ignorance. And all the Brahma or the various notions and complexes created by ignorance. And knowledge alone, understanding alone can remove that. That's why a total emphasis on knowledge. So we need to become very simple people, that's all. From a complex person, become a simple person, that's all. So that's it. And that's simplicity appears to be not simple, that's a different matter. But then, simplicity should be simple. But unfortunately, all my insecurities make me a very complex person. My fears and insecurities make me a very complex person. But all of the discussion that are telling us is just to become a simple person. And simpler I am, the more relaxed I am, and less stress there is. More complex I am, less more tension there is. You know, more complex it is inside means more things I have to balance. And more things I have to balance, more tension there is, you know. Therefore, becoming a simple person, that's a simple, non-demanding person. That automatically means a giving person. How do I know that I become a non-demanding person? Only way to know is to what extent I become a giving person, really. Anyway, so we can now hear. That is why I say, apta kamasya brahmavidha darshadaritya kamaitavya bhave mukti siddha. This is all stated in a very technical way or in a conventional way. So it doesn't convey what it should convey. All these ideas are there, you know, but then they don't seem to get expressed in the manner in which it is traditionally written. And traditionally it is delivered also. These things will be delivered, you know, to in the lectures also. The people also get, that's all. Give up the desires and give up this and give up that, and that's all people get out of the message that they get. But the real, the heart of the message, because Bhashyakara doesn't have time to clarify everything everywhere, you know, and so when the time comes, then he clarifies things. And then he accepts that, assumes that we understand that, you know. Anyway, so, Brahma Vidaha Kamaitavya Bhave Mukti Siddha. For and over Brahma, when there is an absence of Kamata, Kamaitavya, absence of something that is desirable, Mukti Siddha, there is liberation that is established there. Ya eva iti. So, Mahashyakara says, Ya eva atmakamataya aptakamaha saha nishkamaha akamaha akamayamanascha iti muchyade. So, mukti siddha, that's what they say. Yaha, footnote number 3, I guess. Asa ityadi vakyasya artham hetu hetu mad bhavena uktam vasamharati yaya ityadina. Asa, so, asa akamayamana ityadi vakyasya artham. So, you akamayamana, what is it? Then akamaha, nishkamaha, atmakamaha, atmakamaha, yaha akamaha, nishkamaha, aptakamaha, atmakamaha. So, vakyasya artham hetu hetu vad bhavena. Akamayamanaha katham kasmat akamaha, kasmat nishkamaha, kasmat aptakamaha, kasmat atmakamaha. So, atmakamaha becomes the hetu for being aptakamata, that becomes hetu for nishkamata, that becomes hetu for akamata, that becomes hetu for akamayamanata. That's hetu hetu mad bhavena. Hetu hetu mad bhavena uktam upasamharati yaeva ityadina. So, yaha eva atmakamataya aptakama de hetu hetu mad bhavena. Since it is atmakama, therefore he has become aptakama, sa nishkama. So, because all the desires, all the objects have now reduced themselves to atma, so in his vision there is nothing but atma, and therefore, as we said, atma is one thing that can never become the object of desire. Therefore, if everything has become atma, atma is always apta, is always attained, then everything has become attained. Therefore, he has become aptakama. Since everything has been attained, therefore, all the kamas have gone away, become nishkama. Since all the desires have left in, therefore, there is no desire, akamaha. And since there is no desire, therefore, he is not controlled by desire, akamayamana. Ya eva atmakamataya aptakamaha sa nishkamaha akamaha akamayamanascha iti muchyate. And this is how he becomes liberated. Sri Dhananagiri, katham kamaitavya abhavah atmanah tathatvaditya atmanah kamaitavya anātmana tathātvādityāsankyāha nahi iti. Katham kāmaitavya abhāvaha. How come there is an absence of kāmaitavya or something that is desirable? Anātmana tathātvād. Tathātvād means kāmaitavyāt. There is a whole host of anātma, non-self, which can become the object of desire. How come he has become free from the desire? Idyāsankyāha nahi iti. Nahi yasya atma eva sarvam bhavati tasya anatma kamaitavya asti. Nahi yasya atma eva sarvam bhavati. One form of everything has become atma, for him there is no anatma. Had there been anatma, then kamaitavya would have been there. Since there is no non-self, therefore, there is no desirable object. Says, sarvātmatvam anātmakāmetrutvam ca syāt. Nahi yasya ātmā eva sarvam bhavati. That means he has become the sarvātma. He has become the self of all. So let him become the self of all. Says sarvātmatvam anātma kāmaitrutvam ca syāt. He has become self of all. Still, why not there can be anātma which he can desire? So sarvātmatvam and kāmaitrutvam, can they go together? That's the idea. So knowledge amounts to sarvātmatvam. That amounts to aptakāmatvam. So the question is that, can sarvātmatvam And then kama or kamaitattvam, can they be together? Sarvatmatvam, anatma, kamaitattvam chasyat. Maybe he is sarvatma, the self of all, at the same time, he is desirer of anatma. Why not? Iti asangit anatma chayadi. Anatma cha anyaha kamaitavyaha sarvam cha atmaiva abhud iti vipati siddham. Anatma cha anyaha kamaitavyaha. Anatma, non-self, that stands apart from oneself and that can be kamaita, that alone can become the object of desire. Sarvam cha atmaiva abhud. And then also to say that there is an anatma that is desirable, and also to say that everything has become atma, is viprathisiddham. This is contradictory. To say that everything has become atma, and then also to say that there is something anatma that is desirable. How can anatma remain? When everything has become atma, there is no such entity as anatma, and when there is no anatma, there is no kamaitavya or that which is desired. अथ इत्यादि वाक्ये श्रौतमसमुक्त्वा श्रौतमसम अक्षरोत्थम शाब्दमसमुक्त्वा स्वथ अकामयमानः. सो इन दैट वाक्य श्रौतमसम मींस सो अक्षर अक्षरोत्थम द मीनिंग ऑफ द वर्ड्स अकामयमानः अकामः निष्कामः आप्तकामः आत्मकामः सो अक्षरार्थमुक्त्वा और शाब्दम मीनिंग ऑफ द वर्ड्स Shrautamartham uktva artha siddhamartham kathayari. What it amounts to, that's what Bhashyakara says. Arthabhatya. This cannot be unless this is so. So sarvatma darshinaha. Sarvatma darshinaha. Kamaitavya bhavat. Karmanupattihi. It has to come back to this ultimately. So sarvatma darshinaha. One who is sarvatma darshi. So one who sees everything as Atma, kamaitavya bhavat, since there is nothing there that is left to be desired, karma anupattihi, there cannot be karma. Karma means kartavya anupatti. Next word, karma means kartavya anupatti. Kartavya is a bondage, karma is not bondage. Kartavya is something has to be done, that's called kartavya. Karma is something to do, that's all right. I can do things, but I have to do something, now that is bondage. That I want to do something, that's okay. That there is a freedom to do, not to do, or do it whichever way you want. Kartam shakyam, akartam shakyam, anyathava kartam shakyam. That is called freedom. Ishvara has that freedom, and the wise person also has that freedom. But kartavya means what? Something has to be done. Then freedom is not there. So, sarvatma darshinaha, kamaitavya bhavat, karma anupapatti, therefore there is no upapatti. It is not tenable that he has to perform any karma at all. There is no kartavya left for him. So, but karma means, you know, when Bhashyakara is the word karma, we should understand it as kartavya only. Karma does not mean cheshta, that there is no cheshta. Kartavya, that he has to do. Cheshta also he need not do. I mean, that freedom also he has, that he need not do any cheshta. That he can withdraw his mind and then sit quietly, do whatever, you know. So not do chesta, also freedom is there. At the same time, doing the chesta does not in any way deny him the inner peace. The idea is that for his inner peace or inner leisure, he does not have to do anything, that's all. For enjoying the inner leisure, he need not do anything. And if he does something that does not in any way challenge and does not in any way deny him the leisure. So for the leisure he need not do anything, and on account of doing something, he not affect his leisure is not affected. This is freedom. Freedom means inner leisure. That's the freedom. That's all. That I have the leisure. That when there is leisure, then alone there is happiness. You can enjoy things. One can enjoy something only when one enjoys leisure. Otherwise, I can't enjoy. Even a cup of tea I can enjoy, provided there is leisure to enjoy. If I'm in a hurry, I'm getting late, I just gulp the tea, that's all. I swallow my food. I just wear the clothes, you know. I do things. Even though I may purchase those clothes with a great, you know, with a great taste and liking and hope and expectation. When it comes to putting on those clothes, I may just do that. The ornaments I may, you know, I may purchase with a lot of with a lot of fondness, let us say. All looking forward to displaying them, displaying myself, and whatever the purpose is, you know. But then that's all. But then, when it actually comes to that, then you just do things. So all that can become enjoyable. There's nothing wrong in anything, in my opinion, you know. Nothing wrong in anything, if I can enjoy that. And the enjoyment can be there, for where there is leisure. If there is leisure, you don't need anything also, by the way. And anyway, if there is leisure, what else do we need? Whatever we need is to create the leisure. So whether I do something, I do not do something, is all meant to create the leisure, to create a sense of comfort. The when I look at myself in the mirror, I feel comfortable with myself. That's what I need to do. However I feel comfortable, that's what I am required to do. That's called the... Hours and hours together in beauty parlor, they are obliged to do that. But without that, when I look at myself in the mirror, I am just not comfortable. I just don't accept myself. And therefore, I must make myself an acceptable being. And similarly, if I do not accept the world, it is necessary for me to make that part acceptable or necessary that I get away from that. Somehow, I should not be in contact with something that is not acceptable, that's all. That's how upadanam and hanam, acquiring and giving up, these things keep on happening just to create comfort. And comfort means an inner comfort ultimately. So call it inner comfort or inner leisure. This is how Vedantins describe moksha, that's all. For them moksha, liberation, is nothing more than just enjoying that inner leisure. Enjoying the inner leisure, unconditional inner leisure, that's all. Not merely enjoying the leisure, but the leisure that is unconditional, not created by a condition. Or it does not require a condition to be there, that's all. In nirnimitta, it is there for no reason at all. If this can be there, that's it. Because when there is leisure, you can enjoy. You can enjoy yourself and you can enjoy everything around you. When the inner leisure is there, everything can be enjoyed. One can see a piece of art in anything, I guess, you know. Everything, after all, is a part of the creation of God. Even though it may be a creation of human being himself is a creation of God. It's not an ordinary thing, you know. And so, you can see how people, somebody must have given a thought to come up with this kind of a thing. So some creativity is involved, some concern is involved, whatever it is, you know. And so you can enjoy that part, provided my mind is available to see that, number one, and then to enjoy that. So this is moksha. Moksha means a life of happiness, that's all. This is right here. And then later on also, I mean when it is here, it has to be everywhere. Who cares if it is not everywhere? Personally, I don't care anyway whether I remain liberated after death or not, who knows. While we are alive, this is when we are seeking. And of course, as this says, if there is no desire when I leave or when I depart from this body, then nothing can compel me. Desire is only thing that compels me, even to take birth. So no compulsion at all. Karma. So that is why kama itavya bhava karma anupattihi. That means kartavya anupattihi. It is not animal or reasonable that he is to perform any kartavya. Karma jananam matamuttapya. Moment that kamana comes, then nishkamada comes, or the nishkarmya comes, then Bhashyakara must necessarily take up the position of those fellows who insist upon kartavya. Looks like he is opposed to kartavya, he is not. looks like opposed to Mimamsaka, he is not opposed to anything. Bhashyakara is not opposed to anything or anybody. He just wants clarity of understanding, that's all. And therefore, even if he addresses the Mimamsaka of the Karma Jadas, even if he addresses Karma Jadas, just to give them, to create an understanding in them, so that their path also becomes clear. And so, Karma Jada means those who are stuck with something. And so they are stuck, so you must help them get released from them, that's all. So that is the purpose of the discussion. Karma Jadanam Matam Uttapya. So that Mata, the opinion of those people who are wedded to Karma, that means those who look upon the Karma as a means for liberation, that means Karma is something that you cannot give up. This is the firm opinion. Shruti, that means those who believe that you are always obliged. You can never become free from obligation. This is what they believe. Inasmuch as Karma or the Kartavya is a means of returning the favor of fulfilling obligation, those who believe that you can never become free from obligation. This is how we translate, whether they put it that way or not. They say that because Shastra says you should do. But why should Shastra tell you something? Because you need it. That means Shastra also addresses certain need on your part. And so they must therefore believe that one can never become free from need. And Bhashyakara says that one can become free from need even when this body and everything is there. Not only that when the body goes away, but even when the body is. Even when the needs of the body are there. And even when the needs of that body are fulfilled by the very person, even then he is free from need. That's it. Now this is what Bhashyakara has to say. Shruti virodhena sarvasya atmatva pratipadaka shruti virodhena. When Shruti says that aptakama atmakama, so when Shruti uses the expression atmakama, therefore Shruti says sarya sarvasya atmatva pratipadakatvam. So in that by very use of that word, Shruti says that everything is atma. If everything is not atma, one can never become atmakama. So by saying that the wise person is atmakama, Shruti says that everything is atma. So sarvasya atmatva pratipadaka shruti virodhena pratyajaste, that position is refuted by Bhashyakara yetu iti. Okay, we'll continue tomorrow, I think. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnameva Vashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Shankaram Shankaracharyam Keshavam Vadarayanam Sutra Bhashyakrutau Vande Bhagavantau Punah Punah. Ishvaro Guru Ratmevi Murti Bheda Vibhagine Vyoma Vatyapta Dehaya Dakshina Murtaye Namaha. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Hari Om. Tadesha Shloko Bhavati Tadeva Sakta Sahakarmanaiti Lingam Manu Yatra Nishaktamasya Prapyantam Karmanastasya Yatkincheha Karotyam Tasman Lokat Punaraiti Asmai Lokaya Karmane Itinu Kamaya Manaha Atha Kamaya Manaha Yo Kamo Nishkama Apta Kama Atma Kamaha.
Yo Kamo Nishkama Apta Kama Atma Kamaha.
Nitasya Prana Utkramante Brahmaivasan Brahma Pyede. So, kasam puna akamayamano bhavati, therefore Vashyakara said, yasmat kamayamana evam samsarati, asa tasmat akamayamana na kvachit samsarati. Because it is kamayamana, so one who is desiring samsarati, he is the one that is subject to this process of birth and death, the transmigration. Tasmat akamayamana, therefore, the one who has become free from desires, or one is not impelled by the desires, na samsarati. It is desire apparently that which impels a person into the whole cycle of birth and death. So one who is free from the impulsion of desire has become free. That means he is no more compelled. So like a roller coaster, that's how this life is. And one is forced into this roller coaster where he is just made, you know, he is just pushed up and thrown down and so forth. And one becomes free from that when one is no more impelled by the kama. Katham punha kamayamano bhavati. How does he attain a state when he is no more impelled by the kama or the desire? Yeah, akama bhavati. Because so akama means one who no more has any desire for the gross objects, for the objects of the world, no more has desire for the pleasures. Katham akamah, how come he has become free from the desire for the pleasures? Nishkamah, yasmad nirgataha kamaha. Because all the desires have left him. How come all the desires have left him? Katham kamah nirgachandi. Yeh apta kama bhavati. Because all his desires are fulfilled, therefore desires have left him. Aptaha kamaha yena saha apta kamaha. Katham apyande kamaha. How come he has attained all the desires? Atma-kāma-tvena. Because he has become Atma-kāma. Yasya Atma-eva nanyaya-kāma-itavya-vasvantara-bhūta-padāsa-bhavati. For him now there is nothing remains other than Atma. Therefore, all his kāmanas are turned into Atma. Or whatever was kāma-itavya, whatever was thought to be a desirable object, an object of desire, all of this is now reduced to Atma, the Self. Atma eva anantarah, abhashyah, akrusnah, prajnanaghanah, ekarasah. Atma alone, he is free from the ideas of inside, outside, he is complete. Prajnanaghanah, pure consciousness, ekarasah. Homogeneous, meaning not admitting of anatma. Not that anatma is something that is of a class different from the atma. Ekarasah means there is no such thing as anatma. Even though anatma is said to be so, to begin with, only from, because in ignorance that one looks upon something as anatma or non-self, but when the true knowledge of the atma is gained, then one discovers that everything is included in atma. In that I, everything gets included, nothing is excluded, it's a non-excluding or all-inclusive. Atma is all-inclusive. Na urdvam na tiryak na adaha atmanah anyat kamaitavyam vastvantaram. There is nothing above, below, on the sides, anywhere, that can be classified as an object that is desirable other than Atma, because everything is reduced to Atma, or everything has resulted into Atma. Yasya saram atma eva bhut tat kena kam pasye shrunayan manvita vijaniyadva. Where everything is Atma, the knower, the known, the knowing, the knowledge, everything is Atma, then who will know with what? So knower is no different from the known, and that is not different from the object of, I mean the means of knowledge, and that again is not different from the knowledge itself. Evam vijan kam kamayet. So when I discover that this object which I thought is something that I wanted, when I find that this is myself, and myself is something that is already attained, then kam kamayet, what it is that you can desire. In this series itself they will quote this. Kimichan kasya kamaya shairam anusanjvaret. Atmanam Chet Vijaniyat. So this verse will be quoted right here in this connection itself. Gnyayamano yanyatvena padartha kamayitavyo bhavati. When a padartha or an object is known as something different from myself, not just gnyayamanaha, anyatvena gnyayamanaha. When something is known as different from myself, then kamayitavyo bhavati. Then that can become possibly an object of desire. When something is known as different from myself. Nacha sovanyaha brahmavidha aptakamasyasti. But for an over a Brahman who is Atma Kama, so for one for whom everything has become Atma, nothing remains separate from himself. Yeva Atma Kama Daya Apta Kamaha Sanish Kamaha Akamaha Akamayamanasya Iti Muchyade. Yeva Atma Kama Daya Apta Kamaha. Because of being Atma Kama, he is Apta Kama. Therefore he is Nishkama. Therefore Akama. Therefore, akamayamanaha. Niyasya atma eva sarambhavati, tasya anatma kamayitavihasti. Same thing. When niyasya atma eva sarambhavati, when everything has become atma, nothing unknown anatma remains to be desired. Anatma chanya kamayitavih saramcha atma eva bhudri vipratisiddham. To say that everything has become atma, and then also to say that there is something called anatma that is desirable, this is contradictory. Sarvatma darshinaha kamaitavya bhavat karma anupapattihi. Sarvatma darshinaha. So, this is because of the sarvatmatvam. On account of the fact that, so sarvatmatvam anatma kamaitrattvam chasyad iti ashankhya. So, sarvatmatva and anatma kamaitrattva, they cannot remain together. And therefore, when there is no desire, karma anupatti, there is no need for any karma also. And this is what all the time Lord Krishna also wants to tell Arjuna. Nahi kaschit shanabhi jada tishtatya karma krut. A person has no freedom to give up the karma. As long as the pressure of desire is within there, one does not have the freedom to give up the karma. I can give a particular kind of karma that I can do. So a given kind of karma I can give up. Atha chetma hankara nashrosyasi vinangshasi. Ida hankara masyatya nayotsyati manyase. Mithesha vyavasayaste prakritistvam niyokshati. Svabhavajena kaunte nibaddha svena karmana kartum netchasiyan mohat karishyasi avashobitat. Arjun, you can give up this kind of karma, that all you can do. But karma as such you cannot give up. Unless you resolve things within yourself. Unless this, all this unresolved stuff, all the desires only represent unresolved stuff, that's all it is, nothing else. Any desire that I have, it means only that things are not resolved within myself. And unless those things are resolved, and that's the only way, that's how knowledge is to be used. All the knowledge that we gain, all the understanding that we gain about life and about ourselves and about God and about things is all to be ultimately used to as a therapy, that's all. So Vedanta provides the most sophisticated therapy if we use it. That's it. And whatever things arise in our mind, we have to deal with them. We have to understand what's the cause. Ignorance is the cause. Ajnaninavratam jnanam tena mukhyanti jantavaha. Ignorance is the primary cause. Brahma, the delusion, moha, all kind of vibhranti. So, the complex is the second cause. That gives ahankara, mamakara, raga, dvesha, abhinivesha. What else can there be? Nothing can be outside of this. Regardless of what kind of problems there are, they cannot be outside of the scope of this. That's it. Therefore, with the understanding of this, one has to resolve it. And so, just as the yathaidham sadamidhogni basmasat kurute arjuna jnanagni sarvakarmani basmasat kurute tatha. This jnanagni actually reduces everything to ashes. Karma means all desires, means all unresolved stuff. All of that has to be digested, you can call it. Either burnt or digested, whatever. And only when one has done that work that one has become free from all unresolved stuff. There is no pressure inside and therefore there is no compulsion. There is no compulsion at all. Then, as Swami would say, everything becomes a luxury. Even desire can also become a luxury. So anything that I command becomes a luxury. Anything that commands me becomes a bondage. Even desire also can be a luxury. Ichha shakti, you know. So ichha is a shakti. All right, fine, it's a shakti, you know. So ichha, because creatures other than human beings do not have the privilege of desiring. So they cannot desire to change things. They cannot desire to improve things. So even this desire also is a privilege given to the human being. But that very privilege itself can become a curse if you do not know how to deal with it. So all the privileges given to human beings on account of ignorance become curse. Jnana also is a shakti, Ichha also is a shakti, Kriya also is a shakti. All of these shaktis or powers can be very properly utilized for our own benefit and for benefit of the world, provided those powers are available to me. But all those powers are controlled by somebody else, and that is called karma. Because enemy who controls all the powers that I have, and therefore those powers become a curse to me rather than becoming a blessing to me, that's all. So we can see how knowledge can be misused and can become destructive. How kriya shakti, the power to act, also can be misused and abused. And therefore, human being can use them or abuse them. It can be a blessing or it can be a curse. And therefore, whether to make my life a blessing to myself and others is purely my responsibility. Because God has given me whatever I need to get, and subsequently becomes my responsibility. And to make my life a curse, well, that's also my prerogative. But basically, the material that Vedanta provides is adequate to resolve things within ourselves, you know. But unless those things are resolved, one does not have freedom to give up the karma. That's the idea. That means actually karma sannyasa is not something that I can do by my will. It is something that has to happen. Only when I become free from the need of karma, that the karma drops off. And the only way I can become free from need of doing things is when the desires, by desires, we can say that all unresolved things in psychological terms, that's all. So they alone become, they pressurize me and they compel me to do things. And so one is buddhi yoga upashatya. So buddhi yoga is this yoga of knowledge, you know. So as things arise in the mind, keep on dealing with them and resolving them with the help of this knowledge. Karmajananam matamuttapya sruti virodhena pratyachaste. But those who insist that no karma is absolutely required in life, that it is karma that is the means of one's liberation and not jnanam, in short. So whether karma is always a means of apraptasya praptahi. Karma is a means of acquiring something that has not been acquired. And knowledge is a means of discovering what is there. So knowledge is a means of discovering what is there. Knowledge cannot do anything else. Like light is a means of revealing what is there. Light cannot create something which is not there. And so also light of knowledge can only reveal what is there. Whereas karma or action is a means of creating something which is not there. Either you create something which is not there, change something which is there. So utpadana, utpatti, or vikara, or samskara, or apti. You achieve somewhere, you reach somewhere where you are not, create something which is not, change something from one state to the other, or purify something, all of this karma can do. If it is thought that Atma needs to be purified, or Atma has to attain something which is not attained, or Atma must undergo some change or modification to become better, if this is what is thought about Atma, then of course karma becomes a necessity. So it depends upon the concept of Atma that you have. And that will determine what means is required. If Atma is already full and complete, then only means that is required is knowledge. But if Atma is thought to be a desiring being, Atma is thought to be an incomplete or unhappy being, this is what is thought, then karma is required. So karma jadanam. So those people who refuse to think beyond that jadatva. Karma is fine, but jadatva is a blind insistence. And that's the interpretation of Shruti. It's not, you know, they will not say that they are blind, admit that they are blind. Because Shruti says, Yavat jivet, yavat jivam agnihotram juhuyat. As long as one is alive, one should perform the agnihotra adi karma. So this is what Shruti says. And they take these words of the Shruti just literally. That is why Jadatva is there. That you have to take the overall perspective of the whole scriptures and see what it is the scriptures are trying to tell you. And what is the place of a given statement? What's the place of a given section of the Vedas which referenced a whole vision of the Vedas? Of course, there also there is a difference of opinion as to what is the vision of the Vedas. So, whether Upanishads are the primary means of knowledge or Karma Kanda is the primary means of knowledge, whether these fundamental differences are there. Whether Kriya Shakti, that is given, is the primary motive power, or is the Jnana Shakti that is given, that's the primary power that a human being has. But anyway, so, Karma Jadanam, people who cannot think otherwise, and that's all those people who are committed, firmly committed to the idea that it is karma that alone can liberate a person, Mata Muttapya. So, raising their mata, their opinion, Shruti Virodhena, Sarvasya Atmatva Pratipadaka Shruti Virodhena. But Shruti says that Atma is everything. And your insistence that karma alone can be the means of moksha will contradict this statement of the Shruti or this vision of the Shruti that Atma is everything. Everything means what? Atma is already everything. When we say Atma is Sarvatma, means Atma is Sarva, is already everything. Then what can you add in that? Karma can be performed to add something, all right. Karma can be performed to take away something also. Esha mahima brahmanasya navardhade karmanano kaniyan. So, this is a brahmanasya mahima. Esha nitya mahima brahmanasya. This is the nitya mahima, the eternal or everlasting or ever obtaining mahima, the glory of the brahmana or brahma. Navardhade karmanano kaniyan. That glory cannot be improved upon by karma, nor can it be in any way, can be reduced by karma also. Karma can't improve upon it, nor can karma take away anything from that. If this is what Shruti has to say. So what does Shruti say about Atma? That Atma is Sarva. So Atma is everything. If this is what Shruti says, then where is the scope of karma with reference to Atma? So Shruti Virodhena, this very opinion on your part that I must do something to become free contradicts the vision of the Shruti, which says that Atma is already free. That's all. So this is the Virodha. Pratyachaste, that is being refuted here, Yetu Iti, on the page 1215.
Yetu Pratyavaya Pariharartham Karma kalpayante brahma vidope tesham atma eva sarvam bhavate pratyavayasya jihasitavyasya atmanah anyasya abhipretatvat.
ये तो प्रत्यवाय परिहारार्थम कर्म कल्पयन्ति ब्रह्मविदोपि ये तो ब्रह्मविदोपि इवन फॉर नोवर ऑफ ब्रह्म आल्सो कर्म कल्पयन्ति सो दे इमेजिन और प्रोजेक्ट दैट कर्म इज रिक्वायर्ड इवन फॉर नोवर ऑफ ब्रह्म फॉर व्हाट प्रत्यवाय परिहारार्थम परिहारार्थम टू अवॉइड प्रत्यवाय और ए सिन टू अवॉइड द नेगेटिव इफेक्ट कमिंग टू द आत्मा सो इन ऑर्डर दैट आत्मा इज सब्जेक्ट टू प्रत्यवाय. That Atma is Pratyavaya, Akarane Pratyavaya, if you fail to do your perform your duty, then you are incurring a sin. This is what he said. So Pratyavaya Pariharatam, in order to avoid that sin, in the pain that will result from that sin, you must perform your duty. If you fail to perform your duty, then all kinds of... So then the idea is very simple, that life is a matter of give and take, that all the time you are taking something, therefore you must give in return. That's called kartavya. And if you continue to take and fail to give in return, then naturally pratyavaya means that you will cease to receive that favor. You can't always receive the favor without returning the favor. This seems to be the law of nature. Whether that law seems to work or not, anyway, in the society the law doesn't seem to work. There are people who keep on receiving favor. Swami, he has not done anything in his life. So it looks like. But that cannot be so. That cannot be so. One cannot simply keep on receiving favors without returning favor. It's a simple law. Wherever we are, we must always become useful. This is a simple, I always keep telling people, if you want to survive someplace, then you be useful, that's all. Otherwise, you find system rejects you. Every system will accept only when I am useful to the system. This is, may appear to be selfish, but that's how it is. In the law of nature also, nothing that is useless will survive. Everything must always prove its usefulness. Then only it will survive. In nature also, nothing that is useless will survive. Although it is said that it is survival of the fittest, I would say survival of the useful. That's how it must be. In any system, whether it is right, wrong or indifferent, every place has a culture. Maybe not a good culture, but every place has a culture. And it's always a culture that expects things from the members of that scheme, that's how. And therefore, it becomes imperative for all the members constituting a particular scheme or a setup to naturally participate. So as Swami would say, this is a participating world. God has given not only eyes and ears to know things, but hands and legs also. If He had meant only to be here, that's all. All that was necessary to give a head, that's all. Then we can look and then we can hear and we can do all that. But God has given hands and legs, and that is meant to participate. And the whole universe participates. And therefore, participation is the name of the game. If you cease to participate, then you cease to receive the favor. That's all. Simple as that. But whether this has to go on forever or not, is there ever an exception to this? Vedanta says that this law is all right, but there is an exception also. Exception is that apparently without doing anything outwardly you are doing a lot of things. That can happen. That doing does not mean that it has to be done only with hands and legs. That your being also can be doing that. You contribute to the scheme of things not merely by always doing by with the hands and legs. You can contribute to the scheme of things just by being also. That's called a Brahmavid. That's called a knower of the self. I would say not only a Brahmavid, even a seeker of Brahman also. As far as I would say, not only a knower of Brahman, but even a jignasu, even a seeker of Brahman also, by being a seeker, contributes. That is the reason why karma sannyasa is permitted, or karma sannyasa is recommended also for the mumukshus or seekers of Brahman, because it is recognized that by being what they are, and by doing what they do, in terms of seeking Brahman, and in terms of being dedicated to that, that also is fine. So that is another extreme. What happens in all these kind of things, ashrams and so forth and so on, this is a typical scheme, where there is always, it's a system, it's a setup, where everybody is required to participate. But then it stretched to the extreme, to such an extent that people who are just students, let us say, then there is always a grudge against them. These fellows are not doing anything. But they are studying. No, but what are they doing? That they are studying and that they are doing what they are doing is itself, is a contribution to the system. Because after all, what we call an ashram is meant as a place of study. And if there are people who do that, that is a contribution to that place. And they were always working with hands and legs, not only created. So that also is to be recognized. That is why it says karma jadanam, So these discussions we used to have everywhere, everywhere. Because people who are devoted to work will always demand that everybody should do things. I'm not saying that the demand is totally unjust or anything like that, but the thing is that that demand cannot be stretched beyond to infinity, because the time comes when a person, then doing things also, one has to remain secluded or remain, it's a contemplative life also is a life. And ashram is a place which is meant to provide a contemplative atmosphere. That's the idea. So all participation is meant to that, for that anyway. And so therefore people can contemplate, that's the idea. And if you find people are contemplating, that's fine. They're all, you know, this the setup will welcome them so that the purpose for which the whole setup is there is served. But anyway, so therefore these people here, this karmakandis, who think that karma is to be done all the way through and through. Says, pratyavaya, otherwise pratyavaya, the system will not support you, you know. Or the system, you know, means the universe in case of the karmakanda, the system is the universe, that you will cease to receive the support of the universe, that if you don't contribute. Then Bhashyaka has to say that a Brahmavid or a Brahmajnani, by being what he is, contributes. That's the reason why Brahmaparam, Brahmahavi, Brahmagnu, Brahmanahutam, that verse is interpreted as Brahma Yajna. That this very Brahma Darshanam, to see Agni also and Arpanam and Havi and everything as Brahman itself, is performing Yajna. And therefore, even though outwardly it doesn't appear to do anything, he is constantly performing Yajna. And this is done, this is in fact said in more than one places. Even in Prashna Upanishad also it was said that how a wise man, even while he is sleeping, is performing Yajna. That then this whole process of breathing in and out and all of these, they're all compared to Yajna. Even at night also, Yajna is going on. So this Brahma Darshanam itself is the most exalted Yaga. Yajnaya acharatah karma samagram praviniyate. So Yajnaya acharatah karma, his very knowledge itself is Yajna. So Vashyakara says that's the reason why what we call karma, in terms of conventional karma, even if he doesn't appear to be doing, but your main concern is that he must contribute to scheme of things. That's the purpose of karma. Karma also is ultimately, the purpose is to contribute to the scheme of things. That he does by merely being what he is. And so Bhashyakara says that a time comes when in order to be in harmony, the idea is that we should be in harmony. That in order to be in harmony, it is not necessary that you have to do something outwardly, that you can be in harmony by being harmony. So that is the idea here. That yes, karma, that's a general rule, but then ultimately a time comes also when karma in the sense of external activities are not always required. Because they're already included, not that they're not required. They're already included in what one is doing. That's why Chandogya Upanishad said. See, all these prajas, all the people, that sadhu karma kurvanti, whatever good actions they perform, the result of all of it goes to his raikva, you know. So just as in the game of dice, so when you get a dice which has these four dots, then all the rest of the dice are all included, one dot, two dots, three dots, four dots, etc. Similarly also, whatever it is that raikva knows, whoever knows that, to him or to that person, goes the result of all the good actions. That means, so, yavanartha udapane sarvatat sampludote tavan sarvesha vedeshu brahmanasya vijanataha. Lord Krishna said that in Brahma Vidya, the result of all the actions is included. So that verse can be also interpreted to mean that when a person is Brahmavid, he is automatically performing all the karma also. That's what Bhashyakara wants to say. That's why I say Brahma Vidopi Pratyavaya Pariharatam Karma Kalpayanti. See, where is Pratyavaya? Pratyavaya means earning a negative effect. When can it be? When you're not in harmony with the scheme of things. So this flow is that everything is, you know, there is a certain flow in the scheme of things, in terms of activity, in terms of doing things. And when you deliberately don't participate, then you are not in harmony with the scheme of things. Then, of course, there is a pratyavaya. So you rub against something and you are rubbed back. As Swamiji always likes to say, you rub against dharma and you are rubbed against. So you rub your back, bare back, with the bark of a tree, you know. And how you are rubbed against. Similarly also, when you are not in harmony, then there is like being, we are being rubbed. That can be called pratyavaya. Therefore, in order to remain in harmony with the scheme of things, you must participate. You must do things. Bhashyakara would want to say that you are in harmony with things by knowing, because that harmony is not separate from you. If that harmony was something that is different from you, then you have to do something to remain in that harmony. But that harmony turns out to be your own self. See, that Atma itself is a harmony, therefore harmony is the Atma, the very self. Therefore, by being what you are in harmony because you become harmony. So you are harmony, and therefore you are in harmony. So this is what is involved when it is said, pratyavaya pariharatam, in order to avoid that pratyavaya, in order to avoid being rubbed against by not, you know, being in harmony, karma kalpayanti. So those who imagine that you must do karma in terms of enjoined activity duties, etc., then alone you can be in harmony, otherwise you will invite the disfavor, you know, if this is what they say, tesham na atma eva saram bhavati. Of course, this is the virodha, shruti virodha. Shruti says that atma is everything. That means that they do not accept that atma is everything. So those who insist that karma must be performed all the way, they do not accept this statement of the shruti that atma is everything. Why is it? Why do you think so? We don't say that. We are contradicting Shruti. Says you are. Because pratyavayasya, jihasitavyasya, atmanah, anyasya, avipretatvat. See, this is very important. That jihasitavyasya, pratyavayasya. Pratyavaya means a negative effect. That you want to jihasitavyasya. There is a need on your part to discard or give up something. Which you classify as pratyavaya. So you classify something as undesirable, something as negative. And for that, so that is what you must give up. So in order to discard or give up what we call pratyavaya, then you perform your duty. That means you look upon pratyavaya as something that is jihasitavya. You look upon pratyavaya as something which is to be given up. What can you give up? Only that which is not yourself. You cannot give up yourself. Atma is not subject to heyatvam, hana or upadhanam. Atma can neither be acquired, nor Atma can be given up. If pratyavaya is something that you have to give up, it can be given up only when it is thought to be different from yourself. So there is something called pratyavaya. There is something called papa, something called sin, which is I don't want. That means you don't look upon that as yourself, then alone you may not want it. If for a wise person also something remains that he doesn't want, and something remains that he wants in favor of something, so that he wants something in preference to something else, and he doesn't want something because it is not convenient to him, if he still then has this idea of desiring something and not desiring something, or wanting something and not wanting something, that means that he does not see Atma there. Because in Atma, there cannot be hanam and upadanam. That alone is called Atma. And so, anya devatat viditat atho aviditat adhi. As Keno Upanishad said, anya devatat viditat. It is something different from vidita, something different from known. Atho aviditat adhi. It is something above the avidita, unknown. So what is viditam? Viditam is what? Yad viditam. So yad nyayam, tadalpam, martyam, dukkhatmakam, heyam. Anything that is known properly is always known as something limited. And when it is limited, then if I still depend upon them, limited means it is then cannot become the means of happiness, dukkhatmakam, and therefore heyam. So viditam will become heyam, and aviditam as something that is not as yet known alone can become upadeyam or something to be acquired. And therefore, this giving up and acquiring all of this is in the realm of anatma. Inasmuch as for the wise person there does not remain anything that is to be given up, nothing remains that is to be acquired. At the same time, there does not remain anything that is to be given up. You can imagine this. That this person does not give up anything means he does not look upon anything as something to be discarded. when he does not look upon anything as something to be acquired, what it means is that he does not reject anything. Now, if there is something for you to reject, which is what you call pratyavaya, then it is fine. As long as something remains rejectable for you, you must keep on performing karma. But a Brahmavid is one for whom there is nothing to be rejected. Everything is fine. Now that we have to imagine, everything is fine. There was, I think Schweitzer or what was his name was, a saintly person, you know, Albert Schweitzer or somebody. This person used to, he just would live with poor people and with people, you know, he would live in slums. People who are poor, suffering from disease, even leprosy and things like that. And he would live with them, they would also would live, and they would sleep with him, and they would embrace him, you know, hug him. That's how he would then, the whole night they would spend like that. That's all. So much love there was in that person, that everybody also loved him, and there was no bar as to who that person was. No bar at all. So there is nothing to be rejected by that person. Everybody is fine. Now these are big things, I mean, you know, they are not ordinary things at all. Then you do not look upon any person or anything as something to be discarded, to be rejected. Tato nu vijugupsate. There is no jugupsa at all. There is no gruna. There is no dislike. Now what a wonderful thing that is. This is what Brahma Vidya is. So it's not merely some kind of sitting in the armchair, you know, and creating some vrittis and stuff like that, you know. So much importance is given to some mental processes in this Vedanta also, that the life is seem to be forgotten. So people are satisfied that some kind of samadhi and something happened inside and you got everything. That's fine. Provided it transforms you, you know. Provided it transforms you. Then that is how it must result into your whole approach in life. But anyway, so these people are there. There is a Jesus Christ from whom everybody is fine. Everybody is an object of love. Nobody is discarded. So that is the reason why these are ideas that appeal to the people. People who are particularly suffering, you know, to those people the ideas that will appeal to them are these ideas. Because they always feel accepted. And always they feel loved and accepted. And then that is what brings the healing, you know. The reason why someone like Christ could heal anything is only out of power of love. He need not even do any chamatkara. Being what he is, embodiment of love itself is enough to heal anything. But anyway, so this is the kind of ideas that are presented.